In fact, before 2008, Egypt was dealing with informal settlements as just small areas appearing here and there without need of studying the phenomenon and knowing what kind of interventions we should be doing in such areas. It was just mainly providing services and infrastructure whenever we find an informal settlement appears. But then by time we started to realize that the number of informal settlements are increasing. So the country understood that it's not just an area here and there, no, it is expanding and it's all over the country, not only in the capital. This is when Egypt actually realized that no, we need to have a map of the informal settlements in Egypt. Then back in 2008, Sakhret Dweya, the crisis of the 100 people who died, actually made another alert and another call from the government to bear in mind that informal settlements are no longer just something that appears irregularly. No, it's something, a fact that we have to deal with and to understand the reasons behind the phenomena and how can we have a preventive plan in order not to have it expanding here and there more and more. So they established Informal Settlements Development Fund with the first idea was just to study how many areas do we have, what are the types of area, who are the people living in informal settlements, what are the reasons for the people to go and live in unplanned townships. And back, I guess, in 2010, we can say that Informal Settlements Development understood the types of informal settlements in Egypt. We have the unsafe and the unplanned, and the unsafe are of four different grades. So you have grade one, which is a life-threatening, where you have the only option to relocate people because the area itself, you cannot do anything, even industrial work, wouldn't turn the area from unsafe to safe area. And then you have the second one, which is a very famous one when it comes to unsafe areas, with the shacks. So, yeah. And then you have the third one, it's a health-threatening area, people living in an air-polluted neighborhood where close to factories of cements and stuff like this, so you have to help them while the building is absolutely fine, they have the services, they have the infrastructure, but the area is polluted, so it's not good for their own health. And the last one are for the people lacking tenure, so it's a tenure security issue. Egypt established a special government body in 2014 called the Ministry of Urban Renewal and Informal Settlements. The main issue was to understand more and more the people, more than, you know, the building and the construction and the physical. And this is when we had our motto being announced, where humans are the essence of the development of the place. So you don't only work physically, no, you have to understand that you have to provide socio-economic activities and to empower the people living in informal settlements, having certain trainings for them, having socio-economic activities like linking them to the formal sector, having educational programs being tailored especially for them to meet their needs. After Ministry of Informal Settlements had done its job, they understood that now we have the file, socio-economic file, we have the construction, the physical file, and now it's time for intervention on the ground, where the file had been now moved to the Ministry of Housing in order to start building the houses, providing infrastructure, having the services, as well as continuing in doing our socio-economic activities. Very important, actually, because this is what Egypt understood. We cannot do this alone. We have to have our stakeholders with us. And when I'm talking about stakeholders, you're talking about international community, you're talking about the citizens in the streets, the citizens living in the informal settlements, and the citizens of Egypt in general. You're talking about media, private sector, businessmen, NGOs, civil society. So you talk about every stakeholder that could contribute, even with an idea that would solve the problem. Because in Egypt we have 351 areas, which is a big amount actually. If you look at the areas, it's 1% of the total area, but it's unsafe. So, and you have almost 850,000 people living in danger. So you have the stakeholders in your side, definitely, and the people living in informal settlements in order to be in your side, help you understand that you're there to help them, you have to have them in your side. decide, so they are stakeholders in deciding their future, whether they would like to live in the same neighborhood, so we move them temporarily, we upgrade the neighborhood and they come back to where they used to live, or if they would like to go to another neighborhood, so we can provide them with houses, or maybe we can give them money and they can go and rent or purchase a unit at the place they would like to live in. So definitely it's done in a participatory approach. The informal settlements now is part and parcel of the housing strategy of Egypt. So you're not only talking about the other areas, no, informal settlements are dealt with as part and parcel of the planning process of the country. And what the country had done recently is that it developed its own housing strategy, and it has three main components. So component number one deals with the current units actually. So we're trying to close the gap between the demand and the supply. And we understood that why people go to informal settlements, because what we supply is houses for the rich people or for the upper middle class. So we understood now that we have a problem in our current stock. So we're trying to close this gap by encouraging the private sector to build for the low income and the poor people of Egypt. So they will be part, not only sharing by 65% only for the rich people, no, they will be part of this 35% the government is taking on it as a burden, and they are only the government is building for the poor people. So now private sector will be part of this, and by closing the gap and having a new rental system and schemes, this will help people go and find other options. So you have different types, different prices, different sizes. So this is how you will close the gap, and having informal settlements disappearing gradually, where people will be finding units in the where you have social mix as well. Everywhere in Egypt, people can live there from different social background, ethnicity and everything. Definitely, this is done illegally, because usually such kind of townships, they are they exist away from the planning and the strategy of the country. So yeah, usually they lack the tenure and they are, you know, living illegally in the buildings, or they take a state-owned piece of land, or sometimes a privately owned piece of land illegally. But do they have the option to be part of the legal system? Yes, definitely, this is what we're working on. So it's when it comes to a state-owned land, the things are much easier, because it's a state-owned land and this is a citizen. So definitely what the country is trying to do is that if we can give them the land and trying to legalize it, we do this, we go for doing this, by either that we give, they rent a piece of land, or they rent the units built on the piece of land, or they try to pay on a long term, having a mortgage tied system, and they own the land or the unit gradually. But when it comes to a privately owned piece of land, it's the right of another citizen that has been taken away from him. So now you have two Egyptian citizens, and both of them you would like to do it fairly. So what happens that we're trying to make them understand one another in a way that, well, it's either if the person who owns the piece of land is willing to rent it to the person who took it by force, this is an option. So we hold meetings, and we kind of moderating such meetings, and we're trying to close the gap and reach an understanding where both parties will be happy. But if the person who's owning the piece of land needs his piece of land, what we do is that we provide the other person with an alternative land, alternative unit, alternative piece of land, so both citizens will be living, you know, happily, you can say so. I'm so happy that I can see that the international community understood that just like business cannot be done as usual, the international community activities cannot be as usual. You need to look differently and revise the activities and the programs that have been implemented in the past years if you are really to implement the ambitious objectives and principles of this new urban agenda. And this is what I have seen. We are all talking the same language, which is really impressive, developing and developed countries. You now can see us as part of the strategy when you plan your own activities as an international community. So I am hopeful. This is what I can say. Out of Quito, I can see the hope.